You have some people have this philosophy of doing their own time. But in a place like San Quentin, that becomes very complicated, because to do your own time means not to get involved in any other things that are going on. But most of the time when a dude gets killed, he doesn't belong to a group. He gets singled out. A lot of times when groups, you know, antagonistic groups are after each other and it breaks down along a racial line, then it becomes very irrational. And so what happens if a guy's in a particular group, doesn't mean that they're going to go get that guy from the group. Since it's a racial thing, it has a racial connotation to it. It means that they can get anybody as long as he's black, as long as he's white, whatever, you know, whoever's, mm-hmm. you know, the aggressor is going to be. if the Nazis stab some black cat in the dominant black group within the black population, decides to take steps against it, you know, retaliation. Well, then they might just up and catch the first white dude that they see, and he may not even be a Nazi. May not have nothing to do with this shit that's been going on. Doesn't even want to even care anything about it. All he wants to do is do his time and get the fuck out. Gets ripped off, right? Because he's the most vulnerable, because he didn't have anybody helping him. So he becomes the most vulnerable, so he gets ripped off. And vice versa. And this is the way a lot of deaths go down. So a lot of times when you hear about some dude getting killed and they're trying to find a motive for it, well, they can't find a motive, really, other than that this dude, it was just purely a racial thing. This guy just happened to be black or white or whatever the case may have been, and he just happened to be the nearest, most available thing to kill. Most convenient thing. Right. And so it's done, you see. And so he loses his life all of them lose their lives for nothing, because none of that shit's really worth killing anybody over. You know, just a bunch of shit. But it still happens. So the atmosphere there was just really tense. And what was happening was, it was just like every other riot, the whites would win a riot, and then the blacks would win one. And just like it just went that way. And it was never like as far as the victories were concerned, they were all like, nothing was a linear victory. It was just always like a hit and a loss, you know. They wait for retaliation, you know. After, like, if a black group hit a white, then after they did that, they were satisfied until someone hit a black. And then they became dissatisfied.
Whoever attacked won, right?
And whoever got off the ground first was the one that won. And it was always like that, because it was always set up dirty. It was nothing. Yeah, I mean, it was just, I mean, it was just never any of that shit about loyalty and rules of war. That's all dead. You catch a dude on the toilet, all the better. What they call it now is stealing people. You know what I mean? And I mean, it's just that, a dude gets his life stole because he's walking and he knows nothing. The next thing, he's dead. You know what I mean? He doesn't have any idea that he has an enemy or anything, and then just gets ripped off. And so the whole concept behind doing your own time, and the guards are always coming out with this philosophy about do your own number. You're the only one who has a picture on your ID card. When you came in, you were given a picture with a number and all this shit. And then you have no one else. You're not accountable to anybody, and so you don't have to participate in any of this shit. Just do your own number. But that's really easy for them to say. It's hard for a dude to do when he's caught up in that kind of crux. It's just a very complicated thing to do. Do your own number when all that shit's going on. And there's been cases in these groups where guys have came in. Like, say a dude comes from a reception guidance center in Chino, and knows nothing about San Quentin. Never been there, knows no one there at all. Comes in, and just because he's a fish, some dude kills him because he happens to be white or black, for they'll be able to say, well, we killed a white guy or we killed a black guy. So, you know, what they say, we're out of the red, you know, something, you know, we're back up to even kill, or else we're one up or two up or whatever on them. You know, we got so many feathers in our hat and they have to catch up. And it's just an exchange, man. Yeah. And the real true...
It's a ritual.
Right. That's what it is. And the real true dogs of this shit, the real agitators of it, just seemingly never get ripped off. They're always around the kick off another session of this shit, you know? And it just keeps the situation tight. And consequently, it was hard to do anything together. As far as strikes were concerned, Hawker, who is a racist son of a bitch, and a fascist to boot, which enables him to overcome his racism in times of need. You know? It's the son of a bitch. He takes a strike where, like, Mexicans and whites and blacks got together and got their heads together to kick a strike off. Because under all this antagonism and war and shit, they all understand that they're there together. Because every now and then, in moments of truth, existential moments, whatever they are, you can hear them say, like, I know that our real enemy are the pigs. And if we're going to actually make things better for ourselves, we're going to have to get together to do it because we can't do it alone. And they'll get on this kick. And each time, some way or another, the cops start the rumors. They call some dude over, tell me, you know what I hear about the blacks going to do this? They're talking about getting all the white guys in the movie this weekend. And then they'll call some black dude and tell him some shit. And they'll just get, and they'll call some Mexican in and tell him. And invariably what they tell the Mexican is the same thing they tell the white. And generally the Mexicans go with the whites on the fighting. And so the blacks end up fighting the Mexicans and the whites. And so a good food strike or a good work strike gets turned into a good race war. And the authorities all laugh, you know. And they keep the organized thing down. The whole movement for organized labor within the pen is constantly defeated every fucking time by the racist fascist methods. Every fucking time they're successful, they always end up turning them into some kind of shit. The only successful strikes that they've ever had were at Folsom, you know what I mean? Where the racial thing is just always shoved way into the background because the contradiction at Folsom is just so egregious and so blatantly, you know, apparent that everyone knows who the enemy is, and they have their back so far against the wall there at Folsom that they just the idea of fighting amongst each other on a racial basis is just ridiculous. At Folsom are the last true convicts that really understand that they're convicts as a class, and that the prison guards are the enemy, and the establishment, Sacramento, are the motherfucking primary source of all their grievances and not each other. But anyway, getting back to Quentin, it was just so fucking, I mean, like, at Quentin you lived a day at a time, you know, like George talks about in his book, I live a moment at a time or a day at a time, because that's the way you live, because the idea of tomorrow is a very nebulous thing. It's just something that you don't even think about, you know, you don't think about like, well, tomorrow I'm gonna do this and, because tomorrow doesn't mean anything any more than the day. And so you don't, you just have a tendency to, you have, like he says, like you have an ideal of tomorrow. But you live one day at a time. And if you get to tomorrow, well, that's fine. You'll deal with tomorrow when you get there. But as far as like planning ahead, it's just ridiculous. And the idea of talking about, well, you know what I'm going to do, so much good time for I can get out in so many years, it's just the hardest thing to even concoct in your mind, man, because all these fucking dudes are getting ripped off. Or if you don't get ripped off, the chances of you compounding your time are just about 99.9%. You know what I mean? I mean, because all you have to do is get involved in these groups, and that's more time. And then if you get caught with a knife, that's a fight of life. If you kill somebody, it's death row. And so you grow to understand and accept all this shit. It's just being the reality of the day. And so you accept it. Then your philosophy becomes one of you become a complete nihilist in a way. And that you you think that, well, when you get out, well, if I get out, well, it'll be this. But you never actually think really in terms concretely about getting out. You only think about existing there. And so your philosophy changes and you say, well, what has to happen, since this is a Vietnam, we have to deal with it right here. And this is our Vietnam here, and so we can't be thinking about what we're going to do when we get to the streets, even though we have an idea of what it would be like if we do get out, you see. And that's the way it goes. And it just seems like, I don't know if you ever felt like it, I don't know, but it's something like reaching the end of the world. And that's, there's so many cats that walked, I've walked with a lot of dudes on the yard, and they've all said, do you feel like you're at the end of the world? And everybody would say, yeah, man, that's just how I feel it all the time. Like, there's no tomorrow. This is it. You know, you can go not a step farther. In other words, the conditions can get no worse than this, you know. The worst conditions could get other than that is they just up to, and just start shooting and shot you down like you're a dog. And that's just that simple, because there's nothing else. What else can they do? They beat you. They've done that. They've done every motherfucking thing in the book but kill you. And so you really don't give a fuck anymore, in other words. You know, and you even get to the point to where you don't even care whether or not if you get out. Only thing you care about is staying alive. And you live to stay alive. In order to stay alive, and once you get involved in a group, you can't get out. You can't get out. You're in for life. And it's just that simple. It's no getting in and then you're gonna check out. Because for a number of reasons. First of all, you have to think about the group. If you get out, what's the group going to say about it? They might want to rip you off, right? If anything, they're going to definitely blackball the fuck out of you. All right. Then number two, if you've been participating with a particular group against other groups, and you get out the group, and these other people and other groups know that you're not in the group anymore, they're going to kill you because they've been wanting to kill you anyway. And so once you're in for life. And that's why you got the oaths of Ulysses. You can't break the oath because you're in. If you break the oath, you get it dead. One way or another, you're gonna die sooner or later. And if you stay in jail, you're gonna die. Because it'll catch up with you. You can't hide. As I say, you can't run, you can't hide. There's no place to go. Where you gonna run to? Death row?
You've just heard James Carr recounting some of the incidents from Bad, the autobiography of James Carr.